Welcome to today's episode of Talking Point. সবচেয়ে প্রথম আমাদের পবিত্র মাহের রমজানের শুভেচ্ছা এনটিভি পরিবার এবং টকিং পয়েন্ট টিমের তরফ থেকে। In our studios today, we have a very leading personality from Bangladesh, Advocate Sultana Kamal. She doesn't need introduction, but as I always go and try to find things, what is the background of this lady or the gentleman whom I have invited and who has very kindly agreed to give us time despite our very tight schedule in London. Welcome to our show.
Thank you very much.
Sultana Kamal. How are you today?
All right.
What brings you to London at this very hot weather, in this very hot weather?
Well, I actually have come to London to attend a few conferences, mm-hmm. but one of the main conferences was on the ICT, the International Crimes Tribunal, and also to discuss the trial of the war criminals in Bangladesh.
What did you discuss in this International Crimes Tribunal conference?
Well, there are a few questions centering on the procedures of the crime tribunal, mm-hmm. and also many people are actually now raising the question that whether it's necessary to try all these people after 42 years of liberation.
But this question was raised and has been raised for 42 years, isn't it?
That's right. But then the question is still being raised
remain
by
unanswered.
Many. So probably there are people who don't want to be convinced about it, so they need to be convinced all the time. But then, of course, there are certain points that need to be clarified also, mainly because there is a generation who have actually grown up in an atmosphere where they have heard many different things about the liberation war.
Right.
They don't know the basic history or the process that led to our liberation war in 1971. They are not actually that much aware of the language movement that was our basic or the basis of our all these struggles that we conducted in the 50s, 60s and the 70s that culminated in the liberation war. So that's why probably it's actually necessary to talk about it from time to time to different generations and
but in today's world, I mean, I'm sure you agree that at the press of a button we get all the information in front of
you do, but then you also
the camera or the screen. See?
You do, but then you also do get contradictory information pressing the button.
Right.
Because there are many different interest groups that host or post many different information on the social media or the Facebook or Twitter, whatever means are available to them. And it's very likely that people who want to know about the history of Bangladesh, who want to get into the whole process of the liberation war and to really see themselves in the context of Bangladesh now, because nobody lives in an isolation now anymore or cannot say that I'm just a citizen of this country and I have no concern about the rest of the world.
So it's a very small world now.
It's a small world. People feel very international about themselves, and particularly those who belong to Bangladesh originally, but for many reasons they live in many different countries. They want to know that what was the basis of the liberation war and how did it actually culminate in a war that led to
an establishment of this country,
Bangladesh. And
we'll take a few steps backwards, you see, and we'll go back. You were involved in the Freedom War, isn't it? How did it come about? When did you join?
Well,
what did
I can say for myself that I mean I cannot at all kind of, you know, see myself in a position where there will be a liberation war and I'll not be involved in it, mainly because of my family background. Probably it's not absolutely irrelevant to mention here that my mother was Sufia Kamal.
No,
in all the social and cultural movements of Bangladesh.
She's one of the biggest icons of our era.
Well, she was, yes, that's right.
So how did you get involved in the liberation war? Where did you go? Where did you work? What did you do?
Okay, so those are the practical aspects of my involvement. Then, as I said, my mother has been I don't have to reiterate that, but again, I have to say that she was the leader of many of the social movements in Bangladesh, particularly related to women's rights, rights of the downtrodden, and also She was very much engaged in the 1952 language movement, and particularly later in the movements for cultural freedom and cultural autonomy of Bangladesh and women's rights. So that's how she got involved in the processes that at that point of time, it's very, I would say, interesting to note that all these movements were never in isolation from the mainstream political movement.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever movements were there, say for the movement for cultural autonomy or movement for women's rights or movements for the other, you know, segments of the society who were disadvantaged and disenfranchised in the society, all these movements somehow or other related to the mainstream cultural, mainstream political movement led by basically the political leaders of the country. Because at that time it was a struggle against all kinds of oppression by the Pakistani military rulers or Pakistani whoever.
Friends of the, the rulers.
Friends of the rulers. So that's why all the other movements actually tried to relate to each other, connect with each other, and that's why it became so powerful to culminate into a liberation war in 1971.
Right, right. As they say that.
So my since my mother was involved in that, my whole family was basically involved in that. My father was not actively involved, but then he definitely supported my mother to do all these things and also encouraged us to kind of get interest into all these and do as much as we could as, you know, very young kids or at some point of time when we were in university or started our career in the early
70s.
No, I didn't do that. Actually, je kajta amra korchhilam in the Pakistani territory at that time, the Dennis Pakistan, we were engaged in actually helping out people to organize the liberation war and also cross borders, join the liberation force in India and passing information,
training,
and also help them get training, hiding ammunitions and arms in either in our houses or in friends' houses, helping all these friends to really pass information to each other, connect to each other, and then you know, get involved in the liberation war. And at some point of time, we were almost getting exposed I mean, there was an incident which probably I could relate, that if people remember, that we had a sector commander named squadron leader Hamidullah. He was our neighbor, and we actually helped him to go and join the liberation force in 1971. And somehow or other, we were kind of, the chain was getting exposed by some people or some because of some incident that took place at that time. So that's why we had to cross border, and then we wanted to join the liberation force, and we were I remember very gratefully and also with a lot of respect and affection at that time Major Khalid Musharraf, who later became General Khalid Musharraf, he was the sector commander for Sector 2 at that time, and he is the person who actually encouraged us to join the liberation force there. And we started working with a doctor, Captain Akhtar Ahmad, who was an army doctor at that time, but then he defected from the army and joined the liberation force. And he started a small medical center across the border in Shonamura. And when we went and you know, and joined the basic force there, it was only Captain Akhtar Ahmad, his wife, and we two sisters, Saida and myself. So four of us started the medical center, which at some point of time developed into a full-fledged field hospital.
Great, great. Good memories. Exciting.
Well,
see,
yeah,
this is the way our younger generation would come to know. That's what I meant. See, look, this information that was not passed on to younger generations has gone on record. We have done it. What I was going to ask you is that later, after your education, you see, in a school, and you did law, and then you joined your own, you started your own work, good work, human rights. You also worked with United Nations. But before that, see, you went to a particularly very mysterious to me. I used to pass that way when I was young. I used to live in Old Dhaka, and I used to pass by bus to Dhaka College, which was in Dhanmondi, see. And that was the college or school, Nari Shikhamon, their girls' college. And as I was doing my little bit of research, I found that this was established by a lady called Leela Roy or Leela Nag. And she was a great admirer and probably helper of Netaji Subhash Chandra
Bose. She was. Yes.
And I also read that she was in constant touch with him. And before her death, probably sometime in 1970, she wrote to somebody in a letter that Netaji was alive somewhere in India.
She still believed that Netaji was alive somewhere.
She believed, or probably, I do not know, but you wouldn't know anything about that.
No, I didn't know anything about that. In fact, I never had the opportunity to meet her personally, but my mother was a very close colleague of hers in the area of, you know, women's education. And Leela Nag actually established two schools in Dhaka. One is now known as Kamrunnesa Girls High School. Mm-hmm. That used to be known as Deepali School when she established mm-hmm. that one. Mm-hmm. And then this Nari Shikhamundi School, which again now is known as Shere Bangla College and School, or School and College for that matter.
Armani Tola, Armani Tola.
That was in Hatkola.
Hatkola, oh yes.
It's in Old Dhaka. Mm-hmm. It was close to our, actually the house that I was born in. In Tarabag, that was Abhidash Lane, which was a very famous road at that time. And Leela Nag actually was an educationist, and she was an education activist in the sense that she definitely believed in women's education, and she believed that women could be liberated through education, basically. And when she wanted to get into Dhaka University to study English literature, she was not accepted by university on the excuse that women were not to be admitted to this department. But then she fought a legal battle, and she won, and ultimately she was admitted to Dhaka University in the English department, and she was the first woman to graduate from Dhaka University in English literature.
Oh, great. I have read similar things about Calcutta University also, that there was some sort of restriction about
probably that was the
English
culture and rule at that time. Yes.
You passed your BCS exam in 1978,
and I did my law degree in 1978, but then I did my BCS before then.
What made you do that?
Pass the law examination. Okay, I think this is a very significant question. Mainly because I did my first master's in English literature, mm-hmm. and I actually was kind of seeing myself as a teacher of English wherever. But in the 1971 war changed the total mode of my life, in the sense that when I came back from the war, my mother used to get visitors, particularly women visitors, who would come to her with many different questions, many mm-hmm, different mm-hmm. problems, mm-hmm. that she has become a widow now, and her in-laws are not recognizing her property right in the in-laws family, or she has children, but then the in-laws are saying that she will not have the guardianship of the children or custody of the children because she has remarried. Mm. So all those questions, and also in many different ways women are being kind of or had to face many challenges which had some legal implication.
Right.
So that was the time when I started actually looking through legal provisions, that what was actually in law that could help all these women.
Right.
So my father just said that since you are getting interested in this, why don't you study law and get a degree? Because my father's idea was that unless and until you get a recognized degree in any subject, you will not be allowed to give any.
Okay. This very interesting point. We'll take a break, and then we'll come back and talk about further very interesting issue that I have lined up for our viewers. Thank you. Thank you, viewers. Don't go away. We'll be back soon.